And when I was doing in the jury, we were gradually intensified what might be termed our scientific program. With the rise of humanism in the 16th and 17th centuries in Europe, human attention focused almost directly upon the material advancement of society. There is a reason why this collapse has happened. For a long time, the average, even so-called cultured person, had given practically no consideration to the pressing problems of social change. There was no consistent recognition of the rights of man, his rights of decent living, his rights of education, his rights of freedom, his rights to food, his techniques and skills, his garden, his knowledge and understanding. By degrees, however, this emphasis well justified at the time became accepted. Slowly the universe of value disappeared, and in its place came the universe of utility. Progress came to be measured entirely in the physical advancement in the arts and sciences. It is inevitable that this unbalanced condition could ultimately lead to some kind of crisis. Wherever we develop a lopsided, unbalanced, and unreasonable perspective, we will say for it. In the 19th century, we made the dramatic shift from a religious culture to an economic industrial basis. Then the era of invention became dominant. And one discovery after another increased our conveniences and also complicated our problems. So today we have the atomic bomb, which might be regarded as the inevitable end of an entity. It might have been delayed a little longer. The world being what we do, with the pressure made sensitive to two or three sides. Living in a psychological situation such as now today, is moved by forces beyond its control, step by step, relentlessly, and to the present state of affairs. The only way we can understand is to recognize that a human state the immutable processes of cause and effect. We have served the world, now in the least of everything. Had we been more careful, more thoughtful, we would have had a better state of affairs. A dream teaches of its dream, an intention, a great structure, and we never have been able to advance any program with dignity and moderation. The key to situation therefore comes from the each and every one of us. Some of the issues of that nature have been changed. Man has always known the hard work. And you can expect that to go back in your face, or bring to bear upon you some condition
gradual decline of religious intensity, and lower our ethical level, and deepening our internal resistance and distress, and our blessed us with our family members, to our head. We will make the next place during our own intellectual capacity. So we need to learn with what we have. The knowledge is not going to be taken away. It may be possible. We know our bad stuff. And we're lucky in our permanent program. But we still again the breath. We still daily instruments and a device. So now we explain the ability. In the forest of recognize that it's true that lies not in itself, but in ourselves. In terms of life, it's comparatively harmless, and not known, the world is conscious. For the phone is left to be. The man is to be. The individual who has not yet matured his own consciousness, has not yet reached a state of self-discipline, is involved with animation. And we are hoping that one day, that we will not be. Religion has to meet this problem in two ways. First, it has to grow as rapidly as possible within the world. The trend of spirituality is its perversion and the effective use of the planet's power. Which means that from the standpoint
I'm gonna go get some more.
truth. And I know they are going on their way. But no one has to do it. Day by day, they are expanding their minds and their spirits. Not all of them are expanding their minds. But you might think it's all of them. And when you get all of the elements of the world, life is the most of popular media. We'll be right back. Danger itself. Thus we need far as we can, our spiritual integration, or our spiritual consciousness in this emergency. How do we go about it? What will be the problem of religion for us, perhaps for the next several hundred years, as we move more and more into this situation in which our skill can hazard every value which we possess? I think the simple answer for all these things is a series of deeply held, firmly believed acceptances. Man saves most of his energies by acceptance. By acceptance, we do not mean compromise. This is not the point at all. But we must face most of the problems that we cannot solve. With the thought that is expressed in the Bible, suffering to be so now, this means they'll pass away. Therefore, what arises, or what rises over the horizon of our experience, must have a measure of acceptance. Today, we live in a world in which we will either spend most of our time worrying, being afraid, minding, guiding, criticizing, or condemning, or else we must develop a consciousness of acceptance. Whatever negative attitude that we take, every fear, doubt, and anxiety that we know is essentially bad for us. It is the same concept as that expressed in the Shakespearean play. The brave men die but once, and cowards die many days. The individual of an acceptance simply faces the facts. He brings to bear upon that fact all of his knows and all of his fears, but he declines to dramatize it. He takes out of his entire concept and our life the essential superlative in which he brought his own energy. Instead of saying that a thing is good or a thing is bad, the average person takes the attitude that it is awful, awful, awful bad. Awful, awful, awful bad. And all these offers are a lot of time, a lot of energy, and a method of indoctrinating ourselves with a negative but modest technique. And I know that many people are so emotionally destructive that something has to be awful, awful, awful all the time, or they do not know how to live. It's a reasonable point where the world around us is producing so many in such situations that we can no longer afford to react to them and continually mount in tension, or we will disintegrate ourselves before the bomb has set. To meet this particular before the bomb has gone. To meet this particular situation, we have to call upon some of the insight that has discerned evidence that is good and wise life down to the history of human endeavor. bring it now, and I feel DMT is a kind of physical in this world. Man is in this world but not out of it, by his very nature is first to keep. His body expands in the sphere of matter, in his heart, in his mind, and his soul. Understanding in the mysterious world of being primitive, idealism, and spiritual values. Men's fireman world is here. His life can never be complete in the terms of the things that exist here. It makes not much difference how long he lives, but some of it is not long enough for others to be too long, and for very few of them are just right. Whatever we have seen, we have played our instruments and achievements in good time, and passed them on to other generations. We are as real, almost strangers, in the planet that we inhabit. We come for a sign that we depart again. Material, Now is the appropriate boost for the kind word, the good thought, and the helpful deed. Now is the time to bear strength with those we need. Now is the time to endow our children. So, take a deeper interest in our friends. Now is the time to read the good book. Now is the time to develop the latent talents. Now is the time to do anything that needs to be done. We used to say when we retire, we need to do the thing. Now is the time when we must begin the thing. We used to say, tomorrow I will phone my neighbor and wish her well. Now is the time to make that call. Things must move from the concept of infinite procrastination to immediate action. We can live a very long time in a short time to be fuller. The average person in the next 6 weeks will do most of the good things that he will ordinarily get around to in the next 25 years. Because he will space them out. This year we'll make some of the improvements in something. Next year we will know them all. But in the next 6 weeks, we can pile together more value by real good sense of purpose than we might ever have gotten around to that. Among the continuing distractions of our career. Therefore, religion, philosophy, art, music, culture, these things suddenly become things of now, rather than things of sometime. Hopefulness is now. Sincerity is now. Honor is now. We're not going to live a little better when we get a little richer. The time to live better must be now. If we can move, therefore, from this long pattern of things to this immediate recognition of urgency, we can achieve that which is the purpose of our lives. Nature is not really particularly interested in how long we live. Nature may keep a kindly smile upon the centenarian, but it also afflicts him with numerous ills. The purpose of life is growth. Up to very recently, the whole concept of growth has gotten lost. In its place has come the idea that life is an adventure in the fulfillment of ambition. Life is a kind of race in which the important thing is to reach the end as quickly as possible. You don't realize it, but that is the way we live. Instead of that, we have the possibility of experiencing all of the values of life in a comparatively short period. In this way, life is not short, because life really has nothing to do with counting birthdays. Life is actually the record of significant events which have enriched character. This is the normal occurrence of life, as we see it. The average person has a dozen of these significant events, scattered over 70 or 80 years. The rest of the time has been largely devoted to selfishness, thoughtlessness, and indifference. Actually, life, for this person, consists of 12 events. Rest of you. Any event could have been brought much more closely together as the a realization of the importance of getting into life all the growth that we can have. From a religious and spiritual standpoint, there's been considerable discussion, for example, about war. And one man went out in a very short time, perhaps, lost their lives in the service of their country. We wonder whether or not their lives were really short, or whether the wasted time was simply screwed out of them, and the significant things were all of the death. And when we came back after coming very near to death, held this concept very close to himself. He said, in a few weeks, I live a complete life. And nothing that can happen over a long span of years can possibly be what's happened in a few weeks. So under our new concept of things, we could have this immediacy of a people. Now this is a twofold advantage. First, we have no way of knowing if this bomb was ever going to drop. Maybe the world will be wise enough not to last. But if we do begin to build immediate accomplishment into consciousness, consider how much more we will have. The world grows. If you follow this pattern, you are a period of an all lifetime. Supposing that the process of becoming better is recognized as so real and urgent that we can give you the immediate practice of the principles that we hold to be true. And those who have a nice long life, think how much we can get done. People might almost take the attitude that we can live the next 5 lives. And perhaps get a few weeks vacation somewhere along the line. We can outgrow our own weaknesses so much more rapidly if we take this attitude of a new year. Rather than 2, 5, 10 years, bombs do fall, we don't know. We shall then know that regardless of what has happened, we have lived well. We have lived a full life. We have accomplished the purpose we came here to accomplish, and that was to grow. Beyond this, we have no fear. Those anything survives, the do good to complete. And if we have kept faith with reality, realities will certainly keep faith with us. Under these situations, then, we have these two approaches to a spiritual code for this perceived age. The first of these is acceptance, and the other is immediate. Let's consider this problem of acceptance in the terms of Zen and some one of the great mystical systems in the world. If you have known very many people in this world, you have realized that individuals consistently destroy their own lives. They destroy them by building these negative patterns. That nearly everyone has certain beliefs. Destroy them by building these negative patterns. But nearly everyone has certain beliefs in himself, who is such as addiction of alcohol on our part. As degrees, we learn to resent it. We no longer have any sense of value. We whip ourselves and then blame the universe. We destroy our own health and then blame all others. Step by step, we repeat our own character, becoming in the end whiners, complainers, and open rebels, taking our fists to heaven, and for heaven, we don't notice. This time of rejection, the rejection of the simple facts of things, will become a serious psychotic problem that we do not control. The many people do not feel the heart to be scared of this. It just becomes a nagging factor all the way along the life. Something that takes out of life is useless. Your life poor and sloppy and comparatively useless. Once we receive the experience of God in ourselves, for the whiner, the nagger, the fussing, and the fever can never really experience presence of God in person. We accept God with life. We didn't see his accepting a tragedy, but in that tragedy appears the luminous form of divinity. Acceptance is always the short way, the simple path that leads to understanding. We have said acceptance is not condoning. It is faith, that which is necessary. If we have problems to decide, we use every means at our disposal that can be considered thoughtful, reason, and intelligent. We make use of every faculty we possess to bring reason and logic and common sense to bear. When we have done these things, we rest the case. I'm ready to take whatever happens because there is nothing more we can do about it. When we know there is nothing more that we can do, we generally relax. And the moment we are relaxed, the problem itself may evaporate, because problems are pressed into existence by tension only. If the pressure of ourselves, of our own attitude, is an exaggeration which we definitely contribute to a problem, are removed, sometimes the problem becomes so insignificant that it appears ridiculous. And a little problem with a great deal of libido behind it can really become a boost. And most people have taken small things and threaded them into crises of one proportion or another. Then, therefore, takes a very simple attitude on all of these problems. Just to push it down finally, and realize your own identity with space, your own identity with the clear light of heaven, your own identity with the warm softness of the earth, that you are actually a being, that you are yourself and that you are complete to yourself. Everything that you are, contributes to your completeness. Everything that you do creates its own world. You learn in a quietude that is disturbed only by yourself. You might as well get around and realize. There's a lot of noise coming from that. You are a although it appears to be coming from elsewhere. If there are not problems, you are making. If there is confusion, this confusion is arousing to yourself and not in fact. You live in a world of facts. You live in a world of black to black, white to white, or these being the names we've given you. But most people don't see that. They want all the white things to be black, and all the black things to be white. And if this change is not miraculously achieved, they decide to settle down and suffer for the rest of their life. Some individuals insist that their own way is the right way, and that if nature will not adjust to them, well, it will declare war on nature. And it just worries nature to death. And instead of a great fight, we have another Don Quixote, going out planting windmills. And many people like windmills all their lives. Actually, the facts of existence are acceptable to the consciousness of man. Man can live with facts. Man can live with them, work with them, and die with them. And come in the end to a pretty good adjustment with all of these facts. But when he begins to deceive himself, he cannot live with anything. When he begins to demand, he's lost. So everything which we think is either a fact or it is nothing. A fact is an always adapt to. But nothing can take on a thousand mysterious, fantastic forms which still have no substance in any of them. So the great problems of life are the ones which are non-factual. Problems which we invent. Problems which we go out of our way to sustain. Problems for which we will sacrifice years of thought. And when we are through, we have achieved nothing. Well, we have been chasing a will-o'-the-wisp that never did have any substance in it. So acceptance cuts down wear and tear and enables us to cope without emotionalization. Wars are very largely emotionalization, so is time. The strange crooked codes of deceivers have nothing in common with fact. But men have accepted them and struggled with them and suffered with them and died for them. And when it was all done, nothing was accomplished. But when we give our lives to an error, we wasted that life. Nature has tried to tell us this for a long time, but no one was listening. In this atomic, age, we have not to become factual. Factual does not mean cold. It does not mean matter of fact, if we use the term. It does not mean the loss of the warmth and the color of life. It simply means the loss of distortion. The loss of these grimacing ghosts and demons with which we have populated the world in which we live. Facts have the true warmth of a great reality. A great Japanese artist many years ago said that he was convinced the greatest thing in all the world was the fact in art. spoken to a great group of men. The great city and the county school looked at this little town. The son of a real farmer and family, he thought he could buy the legal right. One said, and the critic said to the other, it is perfect. Never did we improve upon this work of art. It has the most wonderful quality of all, and that is humility. It is simple. It was made only for a purpose. But in making it and in fulfilling its purpose, it's in fact in the freedom of ridicule. In fact, the simplicity is their beauty. And these principles that move inside of us are thus destroyed by our own emotional overthrow. As we studied art long enough, we could make that stuff. It would be utterly impossible. That cut had to be made for the soul, not by the training technique. And that is why, first off, the art of God is there.